Hi, here we are again with the second part of an interview with Ferry Schutzler. Is that right? Is that closer to how your name is said?
Switzerland.
Yeah. We're talking about many different things. We're talking about the energy of bees and the what is called the emma, which is a term that Ferry is introducing here. When in our first part of this interview, we were just discussing Rudolf Steiner. So, Ferry, if you had showed me a book and you were starting to talk about Rudolf Steiner, and I'd like to hear a little bit more about that. I know he's the biodynamic guy over 100 years ago that said the bees were going to die out if we continued keeping them the way that we are. Over to you.
Hi Paul. Yes, about Rudolf Steiner. He was a spiritual scientist, and he was the founder of the Anthroposophy. And the Anthroposophy people know some people know about biodynamic agriculture, and people know sometimes about the Waldorf schools. And but the, he talked about many subjects, and but the subject about the bees, I will tell something about it. He was building the Goetheanum, and the Goetheanum is a big building in Switzerland, in Dornach. And that's the center of the Anthroposophy. And when they were building this was in 1923. It was actually the second Goetheanum. That's the name of the building because the first one was burned down, probably by the fascists. When he was building it, there were a lot of laborers, and these people they were a bit jealous of all these people who went to his lectures, and they wanted to have also more knowledge about different aspects of life, and they asked Rudolf Steiner if he would give them also lectures, and he gave them lectures about different subjects. But we're talking about, of course, about the bees. This is in Dutch, it's called de bijen. In English, you have these nine lectures, it's called the bees. And this was for the people who are really working on this building. And these lectures are quite special. And if you want to have knowledge about making splits or all these kind of beekeeping things, this is not a book you should read. If you want to have real knowledge about bees, the inner life of bees, this is so very important. And what I think is so special in this book that he was telling the people, he asked one of the Because one of these laborers, he was a beekeeper. And I think this is the guy who wanted to have knowledge from Rudolf Steiner about beekeeping. And so this book starts, or these lectures start actually with a talk between Steiner and Herr Müller. That was the name of the guy, Müller. And this man, Müller, he gave also a lecture about beekeepers to the other laborers. And Steiner, I think he went also for this lecture, and then he was going to give also lectures about bees. And they were talking, Steiner started these lectures with a talk with this Herr Müller, and he asked him for how many years this artificial, because this was 1923. So this book is really now 100 years old, these lectures, 100 years and a few months now. And he asked this because there was big developments in the beekeeping. So the invention of hives and frames and the whole beekeeping was changing. And Steiner, as a child, he was living in the countryside, and he had also meetings with beekeepers and with bees. But he was asking this man what was the developments of the beekeeping on that moment. And this guy, Müller, he asked Steiner what he was thinking about these new developments. And they were talking about queen breeding and what they called artificial beekeeping. And what Steiner said on that moment, that these new developments would give a lot of advantages in the nearby future. So to improve beekeeping. But he said then, and this is, I think, very special. He said, but if people will go on with this kind of beekeeping, the bees will die. So he said, "In if we would talk 100 years later," he said to this Herr Müller, "we would see a big decline in beekeeping."
And that's what we're seeing now.
And that's what we see now. So this what he said is completely true, especially when we talk about Switzerland, where these lectures were given, and Germany, where you see that there are almost no beekeepers who are able to do a beekeeping who are treatment free. So right. Here the bees are in middle Europe. They are so sick that they cannot cope anymore. And people try and try, and also big bee institutes, also biodynamic bee institutes, they try to go treatment free. And what they see is it doesn't work. The bees die. They die all the time. So this is a huge problem, especially for young beekeepers who want to become a beekeeper and want to go treatment free. They try it and the bees die. And this is the what's happening in the middle, the center of Europe. And it goes also for Austria and also big parts of the Balkans. And as I told you previously, that the situation now in Holland, in England, in France, it's improving. Because there are now many beekeepers there who can be treatment-free, and the bees don't die, they stay alive, and they are improving, and they get better. And if I talk for myself, because I started to treat, I stopped treating about 12, 13 years ago, and I saw that my bees, they stayed alive. They could cope with the varroa, yeah. But they're not doing well. And this took really some years. But now I can say that my bees are doing very well, and I have no problem with varroa at all. But this goes not for all parts of Europe. But that's a whole subject. This has also to do with genetics of right. bees. In right. Holland and in France and in England, you still have the genetics of the dart bee is still there, and this is a very strong bee who is coping well with the climate and the circumstances in these countries. And the biggest problem now is, of course, all these breeds of these institutes, and yes. the Carniolian and the breakfast bees. And they are very weak bees, but they give a lot of honey. But back to this book of Rudolf Steiner, these lectures. I think because I know this book already for many years, and I think it's now I think 35 years ago I discovered this book, and I read it every few years. I pick it up again because yeah, what you can say.
What would you
There are
think?
some. There are some sentences. Sorry.
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut across you. What I was going to ask you was, is there something that really strikes you about what he's saying? Is there something that you do, or some changes that you made in your beekeeping practices that you think helped improve the health of your bees?
Yes. Because I think this the biggest the most important is that he's always talking about the bee colony as a whole being. It's a whole being.
Right.
And in Dutch we have this word imme.
Right.
And this is a very, very old word. This comes back from the Germanic times. So from yeah, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds years ago. And this word is the imme is the whole of the colony. And in German, there is also a word for it. They call it der Bien. And so der Bien, that's the whole of a colony. And if you really think about this whole unity of bees, if and this is you must make a kind of imagination of it to really understand it. That's a whole. And since I think 15 years, also in the scientific world, they talk about a super. They have a word for it.
Super organism.
A super organism. But this is not long ago that they started this word in the scientific word. But if you take this very seriously, that it's a whole, a unity, then you can understand that if you make manipulations in this unity, that it's not for the health of the bees.
Right.
So what
right.
people do many times now is they breed queens and they change queens and they do make splits and they do all kind of manipulations.
Checkerboarding.
But if you have this concept of the wholeness of a colony, the imme, you have a different approach. And then, yeah, for me, this is the most important subject for me as a beekeeper, and what I try to achieve for many years is to have a real connection with the imme, with the wholeness of the colony. And for me, and what I actually did is I have been thinking much about it, about this word imme. And for me, it's actually a spiritual being. So
right,
there is something in a bee colony you cannot see, you cannot wait, but
right.
It's there. It's a spiritual being, what is hidden in a colony. And as a person, you can have a connection with it. And how can you see it? And I think there are, so this is imagination. And when you work, but intuition is something different. Yes,
okay.
Because intuition is a very important word for this. Is because when you have intuition, you know how to act. So if you have this connection with this whole of the colony, with the imme, and this you need a different view of the world to think it. and to recognize it as a reality. And I met many beekeepers all over Europe and in Turkey. And sometimes you have the feeling that some people have this connection. They have really this connection with this being. And how can you recognize it? Because they have healthy bees. And if you you meet these people and you go to have a look how they work with the bees, you see they the bees are quiet and they can open a hive and they don't need these big gloves and these veils and these big bee suits. They can just enter the hive and there is no problem. And this is for me, and I was actually lucky because when I started beekeeping and I did a beekeeping course, it was forbidden in the course to wear gloves. It was forbidden. So the trainer, beekeeper, he said, yeah, but when you cannot handle a sting, don't become a beekeeper. So we don't need, we don't use gloves. And one of the things bees can tell they don't like what you do is by stinging. And if you have this connection with this immer, you can enter the bees and do it in a peaceful way. I think it's very important in this matter is that you, if you have this, you try this, and this is not something you can learn easily or quickly. This takes maybe years to develop. Is and you make mistakes, of course. Huh? You make mistakes too. But for me, what I did, I drink many times coffee with my bees, and I just sit there. And I think this is a very important thing, to be with your bees, with your imme. And people in England or in the United States, they say, "Yeah, I'm going to look at the girls."
Yeah.
And for me, this is strange, you know, because I never will look at that for the bees, the girls. I look for the imme. I look for the colonies, and I am around these colonies. And sometimes I have an idea. I have tomorrow I go to do this or that with the bees, and I go to the bees, and then I get a thought: don't do this, but do that, or don't do anything. And this is so important because I think we as human beings have the possibility to communicate with this imme, with this being. But that's a path, and I think it's very also then important to when you go this way, that you must have the right image of the bee, the right imaginations.
How do you think, Ferry, that a beekeeper could develop that? I mean, maybe not everybody has that intuition yet. How do you think they could develop that?
You can develop it by making mistakes.
I've made a lot of those.
Yeah, and we shouldn't be shy about it. And we make mistakes, and something we do sometimes completely wrong things. But we should learn about from it. Eh?
Yeah.
Because if you don't handle, you don't make mistakes. And if you act in the world, you make mistakes. So making mistakes is a very important way to learn.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yes.
But sometimes it happens. You do some things that work out very well. But I think the important thing is that you have this, you must meditate. So this book of Steiner, I think it's a book, it's not about just reading it, but still I do this. There are some sentences in this book. It takes a long time you must understand what it said, but you have to meditate on it and think a lot about it. And also this whole subject of this being, what you cannot see, but what is organizing the hive and is there, but is also there in different ways depending the state of the bees throughout the year, because this connection of this immer, of this der bin, of this what you cannot see, is different throughout the year. The connection is different in winter and in summer.
Right.
It's also different when the bees make preparations to swarm, and also when they swarm. And that's why this book is so, of the lectures are so important, because he talks about this when the bees are swarming. What you can say also, that in hundreds of years ago, or maybe even 150 years ago or 100 years ago, people were in the culture of beekeeping, in the apiculture in French, people didn't know so much about bees intellectually. So in the last 100 years, there is enormous is libraries full, institutes all over the world, and they make research about all kinds of subjects about genetics, about you name the subject, and it's more going to smaller and smaller and smaller, because DNA we cannot see, but we can think DNA, and we can see the results of what's happening in the DNA, or what we can manipulate also the bees to be more productive and really make changes in the whole organization of these colonies. But what we actually see is that it doesn't bring the make the bees better. It's even making things worse.
I absolutely agree with you. I can just say quickly, I would like to say something, just that. So I run this group called Natural and Regenerative Beekeeping. And most of the people that come on are curious and want to know how it can be done. But there are quite a few people that come on that are very intellectual and have studied everything there is to know about bees. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. It's just that there is something else that is lacking. And this is what you're talking about. You're talking about the imagination, about the intuition, about connecting with the bees. Nobody teaches that. Nobody teaches that aspect of it. We have all the knowledge, you know, of how to manipulate the bees, as you say, to make more honey and, you know, all the genetics. But very few people understand how to calm themselves and get in touch with the bees as a being, rather than just some sort of a money-making or profitable or, you know, business.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true, and we should change this way, because you can say somehow this all this more into, because I'm not a science denier. I think it's science is a great thing, and there is really very interesting scientific research. For instance, I read about this science of this woman in the United States. She has a name from the Balkans, Sivak. This Professor Sivak, and she did research for propolis. Very, very interesting. But this is knowledge. And you can prove it, and she make a double-blind research with colonies. She did all kind of things, and you can learn much about it. But what you can say also is that much of this knowledge in the past times, people have this more instinctively, and so the. And many times we think of people in for 100 years ago, 200 years ago, or longer, that these people were full of superstitions and they were quite stupid, and now we know so much better. And this is not true. And I think it's what you can say, that the knowledge of these beekeepers, this knowledge was not in their head, it was not intellectually.
Yeah,
but this knowledge was in their hands. They knew what to do when. And the biggest problem now in for modern times is people always think in protocols. And when you go to a beekeeping course, is what you learn is the protocol knowledge, how to make a split, when you do it, and how much frames you take out, how many bees you shake out. This is actually what you learn, and it works. Yeah? So if you do this, you follow these protocols, it works. Yeah, until your bees die, and you see it doesn't work. Yeah? So I think it's so important to have a different approach, and not be a science denier, but a science embracer. Because we should use this modern science also to have a bigger understanding of bees. But what we need also is to learn how to act with the bees.
Yeah.
And I think there is this so important, that we should learn different concepts. And one of these concepts, I think, is very important, is the immer. And so there is something what you cannot see and what is organizing the hive.
Right.
I think this is of great importance. And if you do this and you have this knowledge, it will not say you cannot act with the bees, do manipulations, but you can still do it. But you have to do it according the the inner being of the colony, and to understand it. And so we now, you in general, we can say there are different type of beekeepers. You have also natural beekeepers, and they have the bees in trees or in lock hives or in skeps, and they don't touch it. They don't do anything. And I think this is also good to do that. And I think also we need people to do this. And also by doing this, you can help the bees very much. But we must also make new steps. And but I should talk about, I keep it to myself. So Steiner said about this artificial beekeeping, that it will be destructive in the long term if we do it. And but he said also it will give it can give also an improvement. So what sometimes I what I do is when I have a special hive, a special colony, and I always try to select on the dark bee in the Netherlands, yeah, because
right.
this was the dark bee was the bees who were there from
long
the
time.
Ice Age, yeah, from 10,000
yeah.
years.
Is that
and is it
Apis mellifera? Mellifera, is that what it is?
Yeah,
the
that's the scientific name, the dark bee. And still, we are so lucky that on the islands in Holland there are still pure populations of these bees. And but also in the genetics of beekeep in the of the bees in Holland, if you are in an area where there are not too many Buckfast or Carniolian beekeepers, this genetics is still there.
Yes,
and I think
I agree with that.
So I think it's important, and this you need also a skilled eye to look for that. And if you if what I happens to me sometimes, I have very, very good bees, dark bees, and it's not only the color you can recognize it, but you recognize it in all kinds of behaviors of this bee. They are completely different than the modern bees, because I think this is also important. The bees changed so much. If you look back in the history of beekeeping in Europe, you see that the bees were living in very small steps and hives in all different way, all kind of steps all over Europe. They had different kind of steps, but they were much smaller. And also the Carniolian bee, and they originate from Slovenia. And when you see now the Carniolian bees here in Europe, and probably in the United States it will be the same, it's a bee who lives in very, very big hives. But if you look back how the Carniolian bees were kept 100 years ago in Slovenia, there were very small hives. They were very small hives. So in this 100 years of artificial beekeeping, what we can say, the bees changed so much. And this change of the bees, of the genetics, is, I think, the biggest reason for the decline of the bees. It's not only because the environment is not as well as before, but the whole bee changed. And I think, yeah, that's what I think. So I think the connection between this invisible imme, what we cannot see, and in the bees, this connection is not strong anymore. It's very weak, this connection.
Right.
So you can say in terms that the incarnation of the imme is not good anymore, because the body, the visible thing of the colony, is not strong anymore. And we should help to change. And there are different ways to change. So there is also a way just, and there's also scientific work in Holland from Tjerk Blanquière. He's a scientist of the Wageningen University. He tried also to have bees who are varroa resistant. And he could do it in 4 years. He did it several times with different stock of bees. you have to be a very skilled beekeeper to select in these bees. That's a whole subject, how he did it. I won't talk about it too much now because it's too specialized.
Kerry,
but
we have
another way is the natural selection. Eh? So you have hives and you don't do anything, and some hives die and blah blah blah. Eh? And the fittest will survive, and that's called the Darwinian beekeeping.
But it's
and I think it. it
It, you know, people say you don't do anything, but you actually are doing something, and that is you allow them to swarm. And I've always said that the stronger queens are the ones created in a swarm. You know, those are the better and stronger ones. And I think Dr. Seeley was actually saying this, you know, and I believe it's a popular thought now, is that the actual swarming, you know, the queens that are developed after the swarm, the eggs that are chosen are royal eggs. And I think this is one of the biggest, I think this is one of the biggest mistakes that we make when we do splits. And I mean, you can do it and your bees will survive and you will get good bees, but the better ones are the ones that come from swarming.
Yeah.
Now, Ferry, we have 2 minutes left. You want to quickly round up? And is there anything you'd like to quickly say before we close off this second part of this meeting?
I would say, read this book and study it, but read it over the years. That's what I want to say.
But would you call yourself a... Would you call yourself a biodynamic beekeeper, or you just use some of the philosophy?
No. I call myself a biodynamic beekeeper, and I'm a biodynamic beekeeper.
Okay.
Who does sometimes also manipulations with queens?
Okay. Listen, Ferry, I want to really thank you for taking the time on this rather cold Sunday in Europe, you in the Netherlands, and me here in France, for chatting and sharing your wisdom and sharing these ideas. We will put this out on the group for everybody to have a view and see what's possible. So thank you very much.
You're welcome, Paul. It was a big pleasure.
It's always a pleasure. Always a pleasure to chat with you.
Yeah. Okay. Hey, thank you. Also,
okay. Goodbye, and say goodbye to your wife for me as well.
I'll do.